5 o'clock.
Get my thumbs up from technology. Way to go. All right. I call this meeting of the Pearland Independent School District Board of Trustees to order on November 10th, 2020 at 5 p.m. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present, and that this meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code Chapter 551. Let the record show that trustees Carbone, Decker, Gooden, Botkin, and Barry are present. The Board of Trustees of the Pearland Independent School District will now...
Harvey's here.
Where is he? Okay. No, he's not here. He's not in his seat.
Harvey's here.
Murphy's here. All right. The Board of Trustees will now convene into a closed meeting to discuss the following items posted on our agenda this evening, as allowed by Title 5, Chapter 551, Texas Government Code and or the Education Code. The superintendent will present for the board's consideration or discussion of the following matters. And those are sections 551.071, 072, 074, 076, and 082 as listed on the agenda. No voting will take place in the closed meeting. Any action the board wishes to take as a result of discussions in closed session will take place after the board reconvenes in open meeting. It is now 5:01 p.m. and the board will recess into executive session. Thank you. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, the board will reconvene in open session at 6:19 PM. No action was taken during executive session. Is there any motion to be taken from the discussion?
Yes, sir. I move that we accept and approve the superintendent's recommendation for employment of personnel as presented.
Motion Carbone, is there a second?
Second.
Second Decker, any further discussion? Let's vote, all in favor? Motion carries 6-0. Thank you very much. And Ms. Patricia Robinson is here with us. She is the new assistant principal. There she is, how are you? Over. And if you like, the floor is yours. You can share a few words, or not, you can just wave us off and we'll keep going. All right, good deal. Yes, ma'am, congratulations. Thank you very much. We're looking forward to your success. All right, the introductory remarks were listed to be done by Trustee Murphy, but Trustee Murphy has kindly allowed me to, he has yielded me his time to share just a brief moment with you. Let's go with the pledges first. Mr. Murphy, you as the lead us in the pledges.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now the Texas flag. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
All right, Trustee Murphy, do you yield your time, sir?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. The November elections were just last week, and it's been a great 6.5 years, and I wanted to just let everybody know that it has been the honor to serve this district. Moved out here in 2002, never thought I'd think about running for office, but had the opportunity, and you didn't get cheated. I gave you my all, and to everybody out there, all the members of cabinet and staff, it's been a pleasure to work with you and learn from you. You guys are some of the most just conscientious people in this community, and you don't always get your due, right? So thank you very much for what you do for our students every day, what you've done for my students. To the board, thank you guys for putting up with me and learning and working with you guys as well. Dr. Kelly, I appreciate the time that we got to spend here working together as board president and superintendent. I think that time has been extremely productive, and I also appreciate your patience as well. Anyway, with that said, thank you guys very much. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. All right, we'll go to public comment now. And that's what I was doing. I was bringing up my list of speakers. If my count is correct, we have 9 speakers, and each one will have 3 minutes to speak. There's the clock up behind us. We'll bring the clock up. As soon as that's up, we'll get, as a matter of fact, let's just roll. First speaker is Donna Murphy. Floor is yours, ma'am.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity here to speak today. I just wanted to convey some concern that this public space for public testimony is not as accessible as it could be to parents and to students in this district. We are in the middle of a pandemic. There are reasons why you guys have a remote option for our students. We did have a remote option for public testimony prior to the last couple of months. It's not clear to me why that went away. And there was a lot of public participation from my recollection on those Zoom calls. I think that this is, you know, an opportunity for us to kind of redefine how we engage with the public in our district. And so I would encourage you to reinstate the option to participate remotely. People can come here if they are comfortable. I myself was not particularly comfortable. I'm one of what they call the COVID long haulers, as a physician who contracted this disease and has had it for 8 months. I don't think that it's fair for you to impose upon the public in this way, this requirement that they show up in person. I don't speak just as a random physician who happens to have COVID, but I've actually been doing education and organizing and advocacy around this disease for the last 9 months, since February of this year. And I've done that advocacy at the national level as well as at the state level and locally. And, you know, I think this is a very serious concern that could be very easily addressed by this board. And so, again, that is my request to you, is to very seriously consider that. We've done things in the past that I think, you know, really seemed to me, as somebody who is a parent in this district, as deliberately obstructionist, deliberately trying to decrease the amount of public participation. And, you know, that's really problematic. This is the one opportunity that we have as parents, as students, as stakeholders in this district to show up in person, to be heard publicly in an official way, to be registered as a part of, you know, an official record. And I think that, you know, the people who are on this board, who are elected officials, who are people who represent us, right? You're there because of us. You should make this accessible to us. Thank you.
Next speaker will be Ms. Alice Murphy.
Hello, I'm Alice Murphy, a student at Dawson High School. I've spoken here before, last time, about racism in the district, and I intend to continue to address it until action is taken to make every student in Pearland ISD feel safe. As you probably know, there were students at Pearland High School this past week that wore Confederate flag clothing and hats to school. If it's not already blatantly obvious, this was completely inappropriate. Not only did this make students feel uncomfortable, but it apparently continued for the entire week. In the June statement addressing George Floyd's passing, the school board and the superintendent made a declaration against racism and discrimination. Using the language in this statement, students are supposed to feel valued regardless of their religion, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, sexual orientation, or gender. I know for a fact that I would not feel valued at Pearland High School surrounded by students wearing a symbol like that. Students of color have repeatedly received inappropriately severe discipline for offenses that weren't even that major. A teacher called the police on a 6-year-old Muslim boy with Down syndrome for apparent terrorism at CJ Harris Elementary School. A black student at Barry Miller Junior High had his head colored in for a minor dress code violation. A Dawson High School student was shaved by a nurse for having facial hair. Sadly, I could go on. As nice as statements like the one put out in summer are, they're performative and they don't guarantee that plausible action will be taken to protect all students at our schools. I'm here with Pearland Youth Movement and BLM Pearland to say that we demand action. We don't want mere statements anymore. As it was introduced last time, the student-written anti-racist resolution outlines the many ways that Pearland ISD can create a safe environment for diversity of students that we have here. I can see that it's unlikely that this resolution will be passed in its entirety. However, Pearland Youth Movement and BLM Pearland's ask for today is that Pearland ISD simply outlines an effective and transparent response system for racist incidents. This would help to ensure that students are not only treated fairly, but with utmost respect. No student should ever have to be profiled or, in some cases, assaulted as a means of consequence to their actions, even if they were in violation of the rules. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next speaker will be Vidya Muthupile.
Good evening, members of this board. Also, thank you, Mr. Godin, for your service. For those who may not know me, my name is Vidya. My pronouns are she and her, and I'm currently a senior at Dawson High School. I'm speaking today with regards to an anti-racism resolution that was introduced by students at the previous October 13th school board meeting in hopes to continue urging this board to take action on race. Dr. Kelly has kindly referred us, the student organizers, to the Culturally Responsive Council, whom we are happy to meet with. However, we cannot continue to let an unsafe learning environment perpetuated by racism be brushed off into closed-door discussions. As you are well aware, we have once again made the news with the student who wore a Confederate flag to school in the days following the general election. To me, what was alarming was the fact that I had no idea what disciplinary actions would or would not be taken. I did the work of digging around the student handbooks and the codes of conduct. 3 pages dedicated to dress code, at least. Any guesses on how much was dedicated specifically to race-based discrimination? It is mentioned as one word in a laundry list of things that amounts to one bullet point on the Student Code of Conduct and two paragraphs in the Student Handbook. Experiencing racism is deeply traumatic and bears hundreds of years of oppression and brutality behind it. It's not good enough to say that disciplinary measures will be left up to a disciplinary officer or principal of each school when there are three pages worth of specific consequences from the first offense to the second offense to the seventh offense for dress code. Furthermore, this district should be well aware of the implicit bias that our district employees have when deciding disciplinary consequences. Need I remind Pearland ISD of the time that we colored in a black student's head with a Sharpie and the employees were laughing at him? Not to mention that that individual was later promoted. Combined with the lack of explicit consequences and the lack of effective diversity training in this district, race continues to be a cause of an unsafe learning environment in Pearland ISD. This board should prioritize outlining an effective response to racist incidents in the student handbook, including appropriate disciplinary procedures and consequences for discriminatory or racist acts perpetuated by students, teachers, or staff. We cannot continue letting damaging incidents of discrimination and outright racism define the narratives of Pearland ISD students. Far too much is brushed under the rug. I can assure you that even though we do have a reporting system, it's not effective. I personally have multiple teachers right now who have been reported multiple times in the past. Statements like how black students cannot be seen when you turn the lights off unless they smile. This is not acceptable. Just because racism was not intentional does not mean it does not exist. Surely you cannot all accept the fact that passing off racism as an issue to the CRC will solve the problem. You have been elected to make tough decisions, to act on issues that impact our community. Condemning white supremacy and acting on racism is not a tough decision, it's an easy one. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker will be Mrs. Armin Jackson.
Hi.
Good evening.
Hey, how you doing? So I have a really hard time sticking to 3 minutes, but I'm gonna try. So my name is Armin Jackson. I am serving right now, I have the privilege of serving as the choir booster club at Pearland High School president. I just want to say real quick that, because I know you guys can't reply to things, my kids go to Pearland High School, and that incident was taken care of. It wasn't allowed to go on for a week. Just had to get that out there. I'm not saying racism's not a problem, but it was dealt with, because I have kids that go there, and I suggest everybody do their research and figure that out. Plus, you cannot tell people what you're doing to discipline people, because that's against the rules. Sorry, thank you for that. So we've had a lot of things we haven't been able to do as participants in choir. Musical's been canceled. Lots of other things been canceled. The reason we were told a week and a half ago by the committee that decided this that we weren't going to be able to have any live performances even considered until January 2021. Not that they'll happen then, but they won't even be considered till then. A lot of the reasons we were given is that it's not our UIL season. What I need everybody to understand is choir UIL season doesn't matter to kids or the parents. It's not where the heart of choir is. The heart of choir is our winter concert, which is the most highly attended event for choir, single night. Musical overall has more attendance that go to it, but it's two weekends and six performances. So the winter concert is huge. We've been told, you know, with them saying there's nothing to even be considered until January, that takes out Canterbury Christmas tour and our winter concert. And I feel like we've already taken enough away from these kids. So as a kid, you're sitting here watching an entire football season be allowed. I'm all about football. Don't think I'm anti-football. But they're seeing the entire drill team perform. It's not their UIL season. They have a UIL season in spring. You see band perform. I know they have marching UIL very soon. But the whole concept that ours is not UIL doesn't really stand up for criticism. So there's a lot of hypocrisy that the kids see. And they are not, the answers they're being given don't hold a lot of water. There's been no in-class transmission during singing between choir students at all. And they do a lot of singing. So I feel that this is not something unsafe. And I would never propose that, and neither would my choir director. Also, I don't think you know that Kenai has only had 16 people being able to perform at their anthem instead of all 24. No good reason for that when you have the entire band performing. We're asking for consideration for live performances, not in 2021, but right now. So thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The next speaker would be April Stowers. And was that Stowers or Stowers?
Stowers.
Stowers. Good.
That's fine.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hello, I'm April Stowers. I'm the president of the Pearland High School Theater Booster Board. I want to share the impacts to the theater program as well as to the students of the district's decision to delay live performances until possibly January when it's theater's UIL season. While for athletics, a UIL season means many games in front of an audience, for theater, this means only a single one-act play, which is typically limited to a cast and crew of less than 20 students and lasts about 30 minutes. The students involved are already invested in the program with the most advanced skills because they are competing to win. There's typically one pre-competition show for parents and then the competition itself, which may also be only one show unless they advance. So UIL does little for engaging students and building the theater program. So what does accomplish this? Two signature events. One is musical, and the decision to cancel it has already been made, which frankly is inconsistent with other districts around us. The other signature event is Fall Show, which this year is a small virtual production performed primarily in isolation for a lone camera. Previously, Fall Show would have had either a large cast or been double cast to increase student participation and to bring additional interest from family and friends through multiple performances. Students from local junior highs have the opportunity to attend as a group and speak to the cast and crew after the show. Without that audience, the magic and opportunity to inspire young students to engage in performing arts is lost. What could have been a strong year for recruiting and building the program with a new director joining us from West is now languishing. This can be partially rectified if the committee will reconsider and allow the junior high students to come to PHS, watch the virtual showing social distance, and still have the Q&A session. This is key to motivate future students to be a part of PHS program rather than going exclusively to community theaters where performances are continuing. The theater program also needs a way to properly recognize the students who have earned the right to be inducted into National Honor Society. Ceremonies like this for students and are for students and parents with the edict of no live audiences, even masked in distances. This in-person celebration continues to be delayed. In summary, it is truly imperative that live performances are not just a possibility, but are absolutely allowed to proceed. The production being considered for January will be crucial to build the sense of belonging for theater students and a last opportunity for many seniors. We recognize that audiences' size may need to be limited. We recognize that performance and crews will need to be social distance. But the feedback I have received from students is they will take anything to get the experience, the joy of rehearsals with friends and performing live on stage once again. These are unprecedented times and the community needs a place to go and escape reality, and when we believe this can be safe at PHS. Theater is by nature a public performance event. To disallow an audience is to fundamentally change the fine arts curriculum. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, ma'am. The next speaker will be Dula Abdu.
Thank you, good afternoon. I am here in support of the resolution the students are proposing. I just saw it. I have been retired for 20 years and I decided this subject is important to show up. And it is really criminal to create a hostile environment for students because they are our future. You know, they are really an asset to our community, an asset to our nation, an asset to the world. We have to create a very conducive environment so they can thrive and be the best they can be. So in 1984, I moved to Pearland. When I moved to Pearland, because I moved to Texas because, you know, Texas is supposed to be, and it is, one of the most friendly environment, southern hostility and what have you. When I moved to Pearland, I moved to subdivision, and what happened was, in the neighborhood that I was, I start seeing big flags when I moved in. And I have no flag. I'm originally from Africa. I'm from Ethiopia. We weren't colonized because we fought back, you know, foreign aggression, the British, the French, and what have you. So we have that independent spirit. So when I moved down there, I saw one flag in front of my garage. You know, this guy opens it. I see it all the time. Then another one popped up in the middle of the subdivision, in front of my house. So another one in the corner. So I start asking, what is this one? And so eventually people asked, you know, my wife found out. And she told me, and I was really scared for my family, for myself. You know, so, and it is very intimidating. You know, sometimes if you get hit by a brick or a stick or a gun, you know, you can heal. But these things leave a scar on you. And, you know, after that, when I see this flag, really my blood boils because I get scared and, you know, I just really get mad. Why these people hate you? For no reason, you know. African Americans in this country, you know, they were slaves. Then they suffered 400 years of racism and discrimination. You know, think of yourself being a slave and left out without anything, or just a child left without anything. You know, so one of the reasons you have this prejudice, to my belief, is because of economic disparity. You know, you come to an environment that's not giving you all the opportunity. You come to an environment that's not sustaining or equalizing that opportunity, so you are really not get a chance to level the playing field. And you know, there is economic consequences also creating an environment for the school. Parents, they have a choice to take the students to charter school, private school, home school, or move out. You know, when people ask to in Houston where they move, they want to move to Sugarland, they want to go to Pearland. Now Pearland has been, you know, the name has been stained. You know, because of there is an incident. Wow, sorry.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Marcus Turner.
Good evening, board members. My name is Marcus Turner. I'm a concerned parent. And I am here today to express my concern for the dress code violation that took place in Pearland High School last week. To be clear, I'm specifically addressing the fact that Pearland High School students wore Confederate clothing to school. I asked my child how she would feel if she were to come face to face with this incident. She goes to Dawson High School, by the way. Her response was that she would hurry past and do her best to stand clear. Obviously, her reaction would be that of fear. And I find that unacceptable, especially given the fact that I've been a resident of Pearland for over 20 years. Heck, I was here when this was a Walmart. Though my child was not directly affected by this, but someone else's child was. So I'm speaking for them and for my child when she goes back to school. So with that said, I want you all to know that I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed in the fact that these young men chose to stir up chaos, controversy, and hate. And I'm more disappointed that our public school allowed them to slip past the front door. While it is possible that they changed their clothes at school, they were not immediately confronted. For that, I'm disappointed in how the school handled the situation. And I'm also disappointed and the rather tepid response by the Pearland ISD media contact. So given our current political climate in America, these days I want to be assured that Pearland ISD is not passive concerning this issue. I want to see a proactive response to this incident to let folks know that this will not be tolerated.
Thank you, sir. The next speaker will be Etty Gulati.
Good evening, board members. I'd like to speak on the most prevalent issue. Oh, sure. Okay, on the most prevalent issue that has continuously been neglected by this administration: blatant racism. Instances of racial profiling and expression of hate are no stranger to Pearland ISD. In response to said cases, the district has time and time again released empty statements after much prompting and anger, and then took a seemingly concrete step, the creation of the culturally responsive committee. However, with virtually no authority over policy making, the members are merely figureheads positioned to present a facade of cultural sensitivity and keep intact the diminishing reputation of this district. Just earlier this month, students at Pearland High School were seen dressed in the attire of a group that has historically defended the oppression of an entire community based on the concentration of melanin in their skin. One male was seen wearing a shirt with the Confederate flag, and another was seen with the same symbol on its on their hat on his hat. The district chose to more thoroughly respond to a news outlet, ABC 15, than it did to the very concerned parents and students on the disciplinary actions that were taken in address to the two boys. They said that they faced quote-unquote disciplinary action, but they failed to elaborate on what that entails to the very people whose livelihood is contradicted by the demeaning symbol. In seeing the lack of actions the district has taken, students of activist organizations, as previously mentioned, took matters upon themselves, drafting an anti-racism resolution asking the district to commit to efforts towards establishing a safe environment for students that are Black, people of color, and of indigenous populations. The resolution further proposed the acknowledgement of past incidents of racism and the delivering of appropriate transparent responses given to address them, which were to be recorded in an online record-keeping database. This resolution promoted an objective for decreased academic racial disparity, the updating of curriculum for historical accuracy and anti-racist features, and the outlining of suitable disciplinary measures for acts of racism in the student handbook. Instead of deeming a clause of this resolution as unreasonable or invalid, the entire proposal was dismissed at the board meeting on October 13th. With such jurisdiction against competent consideration and sensible decision-making, our schools will not cease to see such incidents of racism and hatred directed towards staff and students from our very own community. Lastly, I would like to reiterate the poor accessibility of board meetings. The poor accessibility of board meetings, not only in terms of proximity from the very people they serve, but also the lack of opportunity for remote public statements. These regulations disproportionately impact those that are immunocompromised and those that have inadequate access to transportation. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker, our final speaker, will be Sitiana Abdu.
Hello, my name is Sitiana Abdu, and I'm a junior at Dawson High School, and I'm here with Black Lives Matter Pearland and Pearland Youth Movement. It is apparent to anyone paying attention that Pearland ISD's efforts to create the diverse and welcoming environment that they boast about are half-hearted and ineffective. The recent event at Pearland High School is not the first time students have openly displayed racist behavior, making other students, including myself, feel unsafe. I would like to ask, were these students, this is a rhetorical question, were they dress coded for the short sleeve or for the Confederate flag that was on the shirt that they were wearing? These students were allowed to walk through the schools for a considerable amount of time without getting disciplined, but students of color are not allowed to walk through the doors of their school without getting dress coded for something as harmless as wearing ripped jeans or a dress that is too short. Keep in mind, these rules are not enforced equally among all students. My experience in Pearland ISD is similar to many other students of color. We all notice a lack of diversity in our advanced classes, which leads teachers into thinking that we are not as smart as other students. Through this and other incidents faced in the district, like teachers making derogatory comments, promoting racist teachers, and continually refusing to condemn white supremacy, it is evident that the district does not prioritize anti-racism among its staff or strive to diversify its AP and GT classes, even though diversity is supposedly a strong suit of this district. In addition, the administration's lackadaisical approach to disciplining racism influences teachers who feel no need to reprimand their students, especially if their superiors aren't. In the eyes of the district, being late to class or out of dress code is worse than being racist. Pearland Youth Movement and Black Lives Matter Pearland, along with the student body as a whole, are tired of Pearland ISD's performative statements and propose our resolution. The Pearland ISD Board of Trustees should prioritize accountability and transparency by explicitly outlining an effective response to racist incidents in the student handbook, including disciplinary procedures, along with a transparent warning system and consequences for discriminatory acts perpetrated by students, teachers, or staff in all schools. Thank you.
Thank you. That was our final speaker. Thank you all very much for coming down. We will move now to the board member committee report. And do any of the members have anything to report from Nothing. What I'll note that Dr. Kelly, there was a safety and security committee meeting, and we'll get you all some notes from that for your edification. All right. The next item will be the consent agenda.
I just wanted to point out that there's also the Pearland Education Foundation.
Yes. Fall fundraiser, I think is what they're calling it.
And that's the Saturday night, the 14th.
14th, right.
So for anyone who's interested, just check out Pearland Education Foundation.
Right.
You can gain more information there.
Right. Not just us. Anybody else out there who wants to go to, y'all can go. All right. The consent agenda is presented as items A, 1 through 4. Is there any item a trustee would like to pull? Hearing none, is there a motion for the consent agenda?
So moved.
All right, motion Carbone, second?
Decker.
Second Decker. Any further discussion? Hearing none, let's vote. All in favor? Motion carries 5-0. Next item is the consider to approve the 2019-2020 audited financial statements. Wade Whitlow is here with us. Thank you, sir.
Good evening. I'm Wade Whitlow, partner with KM&L. Starting off, we had another successful year for the financial statement audit. Georgiani and her staff worked very, very hard to get us all the information we needed to perform our procedures and conduct our audit in an efficient and timely manner. They're a big reason as to why we're here at this meeting with a annual financial report that is top notch. A part of the top notch CAFR that's prepared by Georgiani and her staff has led the district to receive two financial reporting awards, one from the GFOA and then one from ASBO. And these are included in the introductory section of the audit for excellence in reporting. So that's a tremendous credit to Georgiani and her staff and the district as a whole. We're issuing three letters within this annual financial report. The first letter is our opinion on the financial statements themselves. We're issuing an unmodified opinion. That's a clean opinion. So what that tells the reader is after our opinion letter, what they're gonna read is materially and factually correct. The second letter that we're issuing, and it's in the federal award section in the back, is our report on internal control over financial reporting. So what we do as auditors is we come in and we utilize a risk-based approach. And within that approach, we test varying transactions depending on our risk assessment, and that leads us to develop our audit procedures to perform the audit. As we're doing that, if we run across any issues, any deficiencies in internal control, this is the letter where we would report those. We're not issuing an opinion on internal control, but if we find any deficiencies, we report those in that letter. Happy to report that there are no deficiencies in internal controls that we're reporting. The third letter, which is directly behind that letter in the federal award section, is our opinion on compliance with major federal programs. We identified two programs, major federal programs this year that we tested compliance on. The first was the special education grant cluster, and the second was the ESSER grant, which came about from the CARES Act. Within that opinion letter on compliance, we're issuing an unmodified opinion on compliance. We did not find any issues with compliance as it relates to the controls over compliance, and that's also included within that letter. Within the current year, in years past, it's been about 3 years now, where there was a big accounting standard that came out that affected this report. There were no new standards issued that directly affected the district as it relates to this report. We provide limited assurance over the budget. There's three budget versus actuals in here. There's nothing negative that we're reporting from a budget standpoint. Everything looked good from that standpoint as well. Lastly, there are some other letters that are included that aren't in this report that are included with the issuance of it that we're required to issue. There was nothing in that letter that we need to draw anything specific to. It's just there that it's required to be issued by the auditor. So with that, I'll take any questions if anyone has any.
Thank you, sir. Members, any questions? I'll say to Mrs. Carter that every year the report that we get gets better and better with the information and the presentation. So we really appreciate you guys pushing the bar. Thank you for your service on the audit. This has gotten to be what we expect, the unmodified opinions and material correctness. So were there any questions? If there are none, I
got a question, Charles. I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I don't know if this pertains to Georgiani or the auditor, but do we, on page 32, the statement of revenues, do we expect that the 116 day of operating revenue to change at all?
For this year?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
We are, as you saw this last month, we brought a budget amendment, and so the budget deficit increased, and due to the failure of the TRE to pass, remember that budget amendment included those 4 cents that were part of the bond, of the election, I'm sorry, of course is going to increase the deficit. So right now I'm projecting it out, just considering those issues, at about 96 days.
96 days?
Ending next year, and ending this year, I'm sorry. Of course, right now we're still in the middle of a lot of guidance from TEA as far as what they're doing due to the lower enrollment, like any other district. They're holding us harmless, one additional grading period for the first 3 grading periods, or 6 weeks rather, and we don't know how it's gonna look for this next semester. It's likely going to be similar to that. So a lot of our formulas are going to change based on the guidance that we keep receiving from TEA. So it's a moving budget. It typically is about 2-3 times a year you'll see a budget review as the months pass by, but this year in specific is a very challenging year. So there's a lot of unknowns because of COVID.
And are you referring to the one-to-one devices as the budget amendment that
that's part of the budget amendment? Yes.
116 mm-hmm. to 96 days?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
That's part of it, and then of course we've had a lot of expenditures for personal protective equipment and other items related to the pandemic. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions? All right, hearing none, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the 2019-2020 annual financial audit.
So moved.
Was that Mr. Murphy who got in there first?
Yes, sir.
All right. Motion, Murphy. Is there a second?
Decker.
Second, Decker. Any further discussion? Hearing none, let's vote. All in favor? Motion carries 5-0. All right. Thank you.
Thank
you all very much. All right. Next item, Dr. Kelly, consideration to approve the request for state flexibility to meet minimum instructional minutes.
Yes, Mr. President, members of the board. You may remember that last week it was asked of me by the board to draft something that we could address a central problem within the school district this year due to the pandemic, and that is a basically universal belief among teachers and principals and so on that teachers do not have adequate time for planning. They really appreciated the first 4 weeks of school because under TEA's rules, we were allowed to have what's called a hybrid schedule, allowing Friday to be used for those purposes. However, after that first 4 week period expired, that's no longer required. So per your request, I don't know if you can show this on the screen, but I wrote the request. I see it potentially going up to the commissioner at TEA and then also to the legislature when it meets in January. I don't know how fast they can act on this. I had a personal conversation with the commissioner last week about this, and he didn't make, he was receptive, but I'm not sure. I think legitimately in his favor, the issue he would deal with is people's abuse of it, where, because basically our request is that on Fridays, some Fridays, all Fridays, that the school district get the required minutes by just providing asynchronous instruction or remote instruction for at least some Fridays. And I think his concern is that that might be abused in some districts where they turn to an excessive amount of asynchronous instruction rather than on campus. In our case, we certainly wouldn't do that. So I guess I'll stop there. Other than to say the final point in this request is that the Pearland ISD Trustees Administration requests the Texas Education Agency and the Texas Legislature provide greater flexibility with regard to the 75,600 minute requirement, such that a portion of remote-only learning administered by the school district can be counted towards a portion of the minimum minutes requirement and still enable full district ADA funding. So I'll stop there and answer any questions or welcome any edits or however you'd like to approach it.
Dr. Kelly, I know that you spoke with the commissioner, but have you had a chance to talk to any other superintendents?
Yes. Everybody loves the idea. They have a certain amount of skepticism as to whether TEA will go for it.
Right.
But, you know, maybe the outcome of tonight might be for me to then take this to other superintendents and say, would you sign on maybe with your boards?
I guess it would be helpful if we reached out to fellow trustees across other districts that we're friends with or whatever, that we would share this resolution as well from that side.
Yes, ma'am. That would be very helpful.
It seems like if we stand with other districts in our presentation to the TEA, that they may be more receptive to the idea.
Yes, I agree.
So are we seeing the same hardship across other districts? I know you may not have a lot of insight.
Yes, everywhere. Everywhere.
So you're seeing everybody having the same issues?
Call it the same problem everywhere. Now, other thing that the commissioner mentioned to me is he kind of got hit with it cold when I brought it up with him. But he said he thinks at least part of that may be statute related, meaning that he may have to wait on the legislature for guidance. Not necessarily until January. If, for example, Senator Taylor and the others kind of showed we're for this, then maybe he can move a little bit faster, as has already happened with the Hold Harmless funding that we received this semester. That was Senator Taylor and Ed Thompson and others helping us.
So you're saying that after passing this resolution tonight, if we passed it forward to our locally elected and maybe Dan Huberty as the chair on the representative side, that might do us some good?
I would think he in particular would be particularly receptive, Dan Huberty, and of course Senator Taylor maybe on the Senate side.
Dr. Kelly, did when you had the discussion with them, did they talk about the commissioner listening to about failure rates and things like that? Was that part of the discussion?
Yes.
Because a lot of the, from what I'm gathering, there's a whole lot of online teaching, but not a whole lot of online learning.
In fact, when we get to the COVID report, I'm going to give you some statistics on that for us. We're a lot better off than most districts, but in some districts, 50 to 60% of the remote learners are failing one or more subjects.
But the commissioner recognizes it.
And he has helped, and again, I'll get into this in the COVID report, but he has helped with basically giving districts more teeth to be able to say to struggling students, we need you on campus, which would help.
I'll wait for that.
And Dr. Kelly, last month when we started talking about this resolution, one of the pieces that we were talking about was teacher stress, obviously, and this, and you had a meeting following this, I do believe, with our principals or roundabout, but I'm just wondering if you're getting a feeling or feedback as results from principals' discussions with staff. Are they feeling a difference? Are you noticing or hearing anything different? It seems to quiet down on the social media side, but I don't know how you're feeling about it from the
Well, I don't feel like I have a tremendous amount of new information there. That meeting was very, very helpful because all 23 principals spoke in depth about what they were seeing. And their basic message was, this is extremely difficult, the particular model we're under, but we need to stick with it. And the teachers are getting better and better at it. They'd get a lot better at it if we could also have some flexibility for time for them to plan and not always have students.
Well, and I think some of the decisions that you made too was that you lessened the teacher evaluation.
Yes. Yeah, there are several things, and we're going to be bringing to you another couple of ideas in December, which we think will be very meaningful. But essentially, with teacher evaluation, it's reduced to the bare bones for those who need it, and not an elaborate process, which is what Texas normally requires.
Well, I'm wholeheartedly in support of this resolution and look forward to voting on it this evening. Thank you, Dr. Kelly, for bringing it forward.
All right, any other comments? If not, I will entertain a motion.
I make a motion to pass the resolution as presented.
Second.
Motion Carbone, second Decker. Any further discussion? Hearing none, let's vote. All in favor? Motion carries 5-0. All right. Next item is the report on safety audit results for the 2017-2020 cycle. Dr. Kelly, was that in for just board information?
Well, no, there's going to be some explanation, but could Mr. President, could you entertain maybe a 5-minute break for us to get our act together on that?
Sure. You want to skip to something else, or you want to just 5-minute
break? Break would be better, because actually I'm also looking at the next report afterwards that also I need to check and make sure we're ready for.
Okay. We'll do a 5-minute recess at 7:06 p.m. right, we will reconvene at 7:13 p.m. and we will go right into our report on the safety audit results for the 2017-2020 cycle. Mr. Berger.
Yes, sir, Mr. Gooden. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Texas Education Code 37.108 requires that school districts every 3 years do a safety audit, which is really a self-assessment to identify our hazards, threats, and vulnerabilities and work to be proactive in our measures. There was a report typed up, a summary in the board notes. You had an opportunity to read that. If you have any questions or concerns about what was reported, I'm here to answer them for you.
So, along with these recommendations, some of them were, you know, like the intruder, that our report on the
talking about bullet two.
Is it that? Is it bullet two?
Are we talking about the gender?
That, well, just the whole thing that they were able to be there unrecognized for such a period, you know, period of time and that kind of stuff. So,
to clear up that a little bit, only one school allowed us to enter the building without a key. 96% of the campuses kept us out.
Well, that's good.
Then we used a key just to see what would happen if somebody was able to gain entry and how quickly they would be stopped. The male intruder was stopped every time. When I used a female intruder, they were stopped 25% of the time.
Hmm.
So working with Mr. Hayes, who's our new director of school safety, Safe and Secure Schools, we are going to work to be proactively that anybody on the campus that does not have a visitor's badge or an employee badge needs to be stopped, regardless of gender.
Well, that's kind of, I'm glad you clarified that, because it looked like, you know, just random, you know, at any time that this was happening, so that's good.
Yes, yeah, well, that was it was a very comprehensive report on what the recommendations were. Were there any other questions?
Well, I'm saying, like, here on the bullet item four, it says Pearland ISD has implemented layers of additional protection to harden schools in an effort to prevent accessibility. Can you elaborate on that, or is that just too detailed to go into?
Well, a lot of the things you're aware of what we put in the bond. We have, obviously, we're extending the bullet-resistant glass in different areas, the security vestibules, which have been very helpful for protecting our schools, not only from intruders, but also the COVID virus, for helping us with social distancing. Also the lockdown buttons that we've installed, the extensive cameras that we are adding, communication systems that we're adding, and then of course, with Mr. Hayes coming on board, we're adding tabletop exercises, some programming, some drills, some training, and then the main thing we want to focus on are what we call after action reports or after action debriefings. A lot of times something will happen in a school and we deal with it, but because school is so busy, we move on and don't have time to debrief. What do we do right? What do we do wrong? And that's where we learn the most in these emergency situations. So we're going to make sure that we begin to practice those on a regular, proactive basis.
So is that going to be something that's going to, these drills are going to regularly occur?
Yes, sir.
Randomly?
Mr. Hayes is on top of it. And now that he is in place to be the person to watch this and to help the principals become more aware of what is happening, you will see more common information coming about the drills, the safety protocols, and the things we're putting in place.
I know that you were adding more security cameras, and are there specific classrooms that you have targeted for a reason, or is it just more interior? I mean,
the only classrooms we have security cameras in are life skills classrooms, but hallways in different locations where we've installed these lockdown buttons, we want to make sure that we have coverage of that lockdown button, one, to make sure if it's pressed accidentally or intentionally, but no person was there, like a false alarm, we can monitor that and hold that person accountable. And the other is to make sure we increase our coverage of any safety measures or issues or threats that may be coming on the campus. As you know, 2 years ago, we brought the Genetech system on board, which has brought together our access controls and our cameras to help us monitor threats and alerts quicker.
Mr. Berger, do you know how often you will actually perform the same type of audit where you will try to enter the schools and see what the response is?
We are working with Mr. Hayes and the safe department that we want to do it on a monthly basis. We want to do it on a rotation. We got in a habit of, you know, it's a three-year cycle. You get a little lazy and complacent, and you wait till the last year of the three-year cycle to do these things. Now when they have this department in place, we want to make it a regular occurrence that happens regardless of the cycle, because it's best practice.
Thank you.
Mr. Berger, with the masks, you know, and entering schools and stuff like that. I'm assuming that's posed a security issue. How have we?
It is difficult to recognize. I mean, even standing in here, you know people, but you look at them, you're like, do I really know you because of the mask? So it is difficult with students. The lower levels, they don't have IDs. At the higher levels with the high schools, you just push the student IDs. But you'd be amazed at our teachers. They know their kids way better than we do with a mask or without a mask. They can look at how they walk in the hallway and tell you that's Johnny. So it's impressive.
All right, anything further, members?
Thank you very much.
And it may be not the place, but Mr. Gooden, I want to personally thank you for what you did for us when I was a principal at Pearland High School and what you've done for me personally, professionally,
yes,
and
sir.
For the district. Appreciate
yes,
your
sir.
Service.
It's my pleasure. Thank you very much, Mr. Berger. Thank you. All right. The next item, the next report is positive behavior intervention and supports in the restorative practices administration.
Board members, we have both Dr. Nixon over special programs. We also have Bonnie Scheidt, Director of Secondary Curriculum and Instruction in the district. I want to give special kudos to Lisa.
Show the television people at home.
And those special kudos are this. This is the third month in a row that Dr. Nixon has given us a report while she's in the midst of treatment, including today. She has insisted on going through and doing this report. And we all in the senior cabinet and administration, we greatly admire Lisa for right in the middle of all this, doing all this work.
I second that from the board.
Thank you,
you,
Dr.
Thank
Nixon.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Truly our hero.
Wow, great. Thanks. We're done. Okay. I've never said that before in a presentation. Okay. Well, we appreciate having the opportunity to kind of really touch base again. It was about a year ago this month that we first presented our positive behavior intervention supports, or PBIS and restorative practices. And I'm really proud to say that I think we've made a lot of movement towards that. We had, you know, lots of great plans. People were on board, excited to start. We had some really great plans in January and February, and then COVID happened. And so, you know, I wish I could stand before you today and tell you that everything that was on our plans, our action plans, happened. But we had to change gears a little bit. You know, we have one-to-one laptops, we have remote learning. And so a lot of those most pressing needs took priority, which they should have. So we're gonna kind of share with you, review a little bit about the process and where we are and where we're moving on from here. Again, the purpose, there were really three things that we were looking at. First is the culture of responsive discipline, creating safe and conducive learning environments, and then looking at our exclusionary discipline. You know, ideally, we want instruction to be the main focus. And so when discipline or behaviors start to interfere with that, we wanted to try to respond in a more proactive way, to set really clear expectations for our students. And so that's where PBIS comes in. PBIS is a framework that provides for us that opportunity to clearly state our expectations, to practice those expectations in all areas of the building so that everybody is on the same page, we're using the same language. So as it states here, our elementary campuses are actually in year four of our PBIS implementation. So they've gone through and looked at what we call tier one interventions, which are for all students, and tier two interventions with our students that maybe still struggle with behavior. This is our first year for implementation for middle school, junior high, and high school. The primary thing this year that we're all doing is looking at our school-wide behavior expectations of be safe, be respectful, and be responsible. So throughout the building, whether it's the cafeteria, it's a classroom, it's out on an athletic field, all of our expectations are surrounded by those three expectations, so that the language is consistent from K-12 when we talk with students about behavior, because it must be taught, just like our academic skills. It's always going to be around our be safe, be respectful, be responsible. The second component for our group was restorative practices. You know, we need to look at building community, and we need to be
building positive relationships between students and with our teachers and staff and our students. And the restorative practices guide us to that. There's many strategies within restorative practices that would allow us to do that. One of the things that our group is focusing on is also using data as a tool. Part of PBIS is to look at your discipline data and be able to identify where are some areas of concern. Are there significant numbers of incidents in the cafeteria? So if so, we need to look at that. So just as an example for you, one of the things that we look at, this is a discipline action summary. It is something that is submitted through PEAMS. But what it looks at is, in this case, what we call exclusionary discipline, which is ISS and OSS. So by looking at data like this, when we look at all students, which is that top row is all students, and we look at each of the student groups, and we look at race, ethnicity, male, female, special ed, economically disadvantaged, we want to look at those groups and see, is there any differences or discrepancies between and among those? If there's some areas that is really going well, whether it's for the district or even particular campuses, what is that campus doing? What is something that we could replicate at the other campuses? So one of the focuses of PBIS and why we selected that is that it does have that very objective data piece that allows us to really look at how are we doing and where are some areas that we may need to focus on. And so we're working with both our district leadership team and our campus leadership team on learning how to do that. And with our elementaries, they've had an opportunity to have some coaching, and Don Lissy is here. We use Emergent Tree, and each campus has that opportunity for some individual coaching on how do I use our data to help our campus. And so now, Bonnie is gonna share a little bit more as we move into our leadership team.
So like Lisa said earlier, we had a lot of momentum going on the implementation. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about what we kind of did before COVID, and then we were still able to implement quite a few things this summer in regards to professional development for our administrators. You know, we were going forward, we had a lot of plans, and now we wanna kind of regroup and come back and see where we can make adjustments to continue this implementation. One of the things that we did is we put together a district leadership team. It was a group of administrators, principals, assistant principals, and a lot of them that were on this team were very passionate about implementation of PBIS and restorative practices. And we met and we basically came up with a 10-part framework of implementation, and we broke off into small subgroups, and in those subgroups we developed an action plan for each one of these components of our framework. Each component had strategies, or each action plan had strategies, had people responsible, who the stakeholders are going to be, and then what we needed to make sure that happened. This is just an example. Professional development was a big part of our action plan. How are we going to provide PD to our administrators and our teachers? So what we have done, what we were able to accomplish in light of COVID, is we were still able to bring Dr. Lang from TEA to our district via Zoom. She was able to hold three overview trainings for our administrators, some counselors, and some of our APs. It wasn't the same as in person, but it was still a very thorough training that we were able to provide. We did that over the summer. We also provided an administrator PBIS overview training this summer in June. It did focus on the school-wide expectations for PBIS, so we can have that consistent, be safe, be respectful, be responsible across K-12. And then Dr. Nixon, of course, she provided a great training to our elementary APs on respect agreements and circles, which are tier one interventions that fall under restorative practices. And you have a book that we were able to provide you with. Each of our administrators that participated in our training received the Restorative Discipline for Schools, little book of Restorative Discipline for Schools, and we also were able to provide some other tools and resources for our campuses. So one of the other parts that we are in the works, I would have to say is in the works, is regrouping and coming back, because one piece within our framework is developing a campus behavior leadership team. And that campus behavior leadership team should consist of a diverse group of members. They also need to start with what Lisa said, looking at the data, looking at the specific data at their campuses and where they can make improvements. So some campuses have been doing this for years. Some we need to, you know, come back and work with those administrators and develop those campus behavior leadership teams. A couple things that we have coming up, hopefully when we do get that momentum back, we want to come back to Dr. Lang from TEA and go forward with training, the two-day training that comes after that administrative overview, and provide that to specific leaders on our campuses. We have put in place remote learning school-wide behavior expectations. So some of those students that are participating in remote learning, they have received their be safe, be respectful, be responsible, basically their expectations of how they can should conduct themselves at home while they are remote learning. And we have also had the opportunity, or have been selected, our district has been selected to participate in a Region 4 Equity Collaborative. Mr. Berger, Dr. Watson, myself, and Dr. Vaughn and Dr. Nixon, the five of us are getting to participate in that collaborative. We have had one session thus far, and we're really excited of what we can learn going forward and what we can take back and strategies we can bring back to the district. And then I think you discussed year four collaboration with Emergentry. That's been working well. Don Lissy has been planning with elementary campuses and implementation of PBIS for quite some time. So we're hoping to continue that momentum into grades 5 through 12. And that's all we have. Y'all have questions?
So what's your end? I mean, we talked about the last time y'all were here, the end game, and trying to be able to control ISS situations and things of that sort. Is there any data to support whether or not this type of this is really working in that area, or is it kind of too early to tell?
I would say that at this point it's probably a little bit too early to tell, just because as we were just beginning to get organized and to develop those campus teams, where campuses were making plans to start this school year, that got interrupted by COVID. I can tell you from the research, yes, this will definitely help with that exclusionary discipline. And that's really what we're looking at, is trying to keep kids in class. You know, you want to create positive learning environments, but you also want to, you know, try to do whatever we can to help that behavior such a way that we don't send them to ISS, you know, to keep them. And if there is a behavior, let's say a student does something and there has to be a consequence, intervening at that point to say, okay, you made a mistake. Do you understand why is it that you did that? You know, if we have a kid that has 38 tardies and has been to ISS for 6 days, right? Why is that student tardy? Maybe it's really far and the student's not good at advocating for himself and, you know, doesn't say anything, or feels like the teacher doesn't like him and so he doesn't want to go to that class, where perhaps a conference or a conversation could remediate that situation. So that data piece is really helpful, because when you start to see a pattern, you can intervene. And so that's what both that PBIS piece, to clearly state these are the expectations, and to teach kids behavior, even middle school, junior high, and high school. How do I behave? How do I respond to adults? And then be able to form those relationships through restorative practices, so that you can have those conversations when you start to see those patterns of behavior, to say, hey, talk to me, what's happening here? We don't want this to keep continuing. Because that a lot of our ISS is really repeated behaviors. So if we can intervene after the first or second time, then we could greatly reduce the number of days kids are out of class.
So you're talking about the infractions that are, I guess, less severe or something like that. I mean, in years past, we've had instances of vaping, for example. I mean, you know, just to pick something out of the blue, that's kind of mid-level, I guess. How would you guys intervene in that situation?
There's a couple of things we would do. One is that, you know, we need to identify, is it just once that it's happened? If it's a student that goes back that second time, then there's questions about what can we do to intervene? Is there student education? Is there parent education? You know, vaping's a difficult one because it's new for all of us. And so trying to identify, again, why students are doing it, what are they getting out of that, and helping them understand how dangerous it is for them, but how do I make a better choice as a student? How do we motivate that student to want to make a better choice?
So you're finding the root cause and going and trying to correct that.
Would dress code infractions fall into that scenario?
Yes. I would say looking at our data of ISS, especially at the secondary level, there's a lot of tardies, you know, that just accumulate. And so I think by looking at the data, if we can step in and say, wait, I see that you've been tardy, you know, five times, but only the sixth period, then we look, are there a lot of, you know, do I have a 28 in that class? You know, what may be happening? Am I intimidated by another student in that class? You know, having that conversation with that student. And so we've got to be talking to students in order for them to feel comfortable really opening up when there's a problem.
And how many times might you want to have this conversation before you actually say, okay, now this isn't working. What's the next step? I guess that would be ISS or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, is there a number?
It's hard to have a number. You know, as an assistant principal, it would be easy. You know, my job as an assistant principal would have been easy if you told me, you know, here's your chart, just kind of find it and go. But every situation with every student is so different that really, in order to correct the behavior, to really find out what's happening and come up together with a good solution, you're going to have to really, you know, investigate. You're going to have to talk to the teacher, talk to the parents, you know, check grades, check attendance, you know, observe the student. As an assistant principal at secondary, you can kind of watch. You know, if I know that Bonnie's late to sixth period every day, I might kind of hang around where that sixth period classroom is and say, you know, what's happening there? If I see a bunch of kids that are standing there, and once they go into class, Bonnie goes in, hey, I know there's a problem right there. So it's trying to do that. Now, it's hard. I mean, it sounds easy. As an assistant principal, you've got so much to do, but it's kind of like putting that time in on the front end would ideally save a little bit, you know, once you're able to intervene. It sounds easy, but it
doesn't sound
tough.
Easy to me, to be honest with you. I mean, it sounds very difficult.
It takes time, and that's what's really, I think, hard for our administrators is they have so many jobs every single day, you know, and so it's trying for us, I think, and with this to create a framework that makes them more efficient.
I can interrupt or offer one other idea, I think for me, the way I think about it is that we're being charged with not just educating our children in reading, writing, math, and all of the subjects that they take, but we're also being charged with teaching them how to behave or teaching them how to respond correctly in an environment. And I think there's all kinds of things that are mitigating factors from the outside world or parenting and kind of the way parents are pulled that we're charged with teaching kids discipline, and we're charged with teaching them how to fit in a greater world and a greater classroom and how to respond to their peers and what their impact or influence is on and the way their behaviors impact others. And so it really is teaching it, you know, taking it on as another subject in which we're starting at the elementary level and building and teaching them responsible behaviors throughout their career in our schools. That concept of a well-rounded student when they leave is not just about all the educational factors, but it's about behavior and how to know how to exist in the world too.
And just to piggyback off of that, a lot of what we are trying to put in place right now, and I go back to the tier one intervention, it's the building blocks. We're not just, you know, some of these kids that have been dealing with discipline over the years, if we would have been able to build that relationship from the beginning with that student, we could have relieved some of the things that they may be doing or teach those expectations ahead of time. So we're starting with that tier one with our administrators and then hopefully going on to our teachers and so on.
But I'd say it's a different frame of mind for our teachers and administrators too. It's a really different way of thinking about how we do education. And so it kind of tilts everything they do where it's tended to be a lot very consequence driven, like conduct marks and those kinds of things. But this is kind of flipping it around and saying, what can I do to positively and reinforce the good behavior so that we don't see as much of the negative behavior? So it really is just kind of a paradigm shift of how you think about discipline.
And that's hard if you're...
But in this case, it only comes up when the bad behavior occurs.
Well, I don't...
Intervention.
No, what they're offering is a foundation of how to reinforce the good behaviors and then what to do in the place of severe consequences should the bad behavior happen. And then there's still going to be times where consequences are needed. It's just that you'd hope to minimize the severe consequences for a big group of kids early on without having to use those. And those are kind of, when I worked in classrooms, I would tell parents to keep no's as diamonds in their pocket. Like, you don't want to say no or stop, so that when you do say it, it's meaningful and it means something. And I think the same way about teachers in the classroom. If you keep giving conduct marks, the kids become so desensitized to them that they aren't meaningful anymore when you start giving them. And so it kind of escalates because now D-Hall doesn't work anymore, and now we have to go to ISS. And for some kids, especially if they have learning issues, then they didn't learn to read effectively in third grade, and now they're struggling academically to sit in the classroom and learn. And now by the time we're in eighth grade, and now I have to use my reading skills to really learn something, my behavior comes out instead. And how do we be preventative for that kid ahead of time rather than being reactionary with consequences?
So that all works great for our kind of semi-controlled environment, I guess. But what happens? Are there studies that show what the statistics are on behavior as it's learned through this process into the real world? So when these kids go to college or they find a job and they're dealing with societal, typical societal issues, is this something that they're going to carry along with them? I mean, I know the perfect answer is yes, but from a data perspective, are there truly those studies that say yes, that works?
I think part of the restorative practices piece, when you're forming relationships, like we talk about circles for the tier one intervention, where they all have to sit down and learn and talk with one another, I think that helps, because then they would have an opportunity to talk with and interact with people maybe that they wouldn't have normally chosen to. You know, they might have just sat in the classroom and only talked to that one other student that they knew. So I think there's a piece there. I think the other piece on the PBIS side, that's also about teaching behaviors. You know, how do you behave when? And so, you know, it's getting even, you know, our secondary teachers, again, our junior high and high school teachers, to think about, you know, at elementary, we teach them how we want them to walk down the halls and go to the cafeteria. I mean, kindergarten teachers are masters at that. They explicitly teach everything, and the kids follow. By high school, we think, well, they know it, but not necessarily. You know, they may not. You know, all our students, you know, may not have those skills to really understand what's expected of them. And so still teaching that is important. Now, we need to do it in a way that's engaging for our high schoolers. We would teach it differently than we would at the younger grades. But I think having that opportunity to understand, you know, when I'm at school, it's kind of like when I'm in college or when I'm at work, there's different behavior expectations than perhaps when I'm with friends or at home, that kind of thing. So I think there's a little carryover there. I don't know how direct it would be. I mean, I'm happy to research that.
I don't necessarily expect that. The messaging, I guess, what I'm getting is, you know, continued, you know, reiteration of the messaging across, you know, from K through 12, you know, results in, you know, behaviors that would be contrary to where they would without it, right? So,
you know, Jeff, when I did this in 2009 and 2010, I actually went around the state and did all this, you know, CBISS, you know, trying to take collaborative ISS rooms and turn them into collaborative working environments and get the kids to graduate out of the ISS room, right? So they would get marks, right? Within the ISS room, they would get, if you did this, you get a mark, you did this, you did all these good things, and they had a four-day placement, they would graduate and they would see accomplishment right there. And the big portion of that is how to argue appropriately with the person you disagree with. And absolutely that carries on into the workforce. It's a big portion of this is how can you get your point across without screaming to the top of your lungs or get mad and leave the room. And so that carries on to, I wish my own son sometimes could learn a little bit of that, you know, especially going into the work environment. How do you tell your boss, you know, that you're dissatisfied with your job without just getting mad and quit? Because that's a big portion of this, is teaching these kids at a younger age, and then, you know, as the level goes up, you know, getting all those things in a learned, you know, behavior. Cause that's just level one. But then, you know, I know a lot of people's concern is, you know, what if a kid acts this way? Is there a, does it go directly to an ISS room, or, you know, wherever the case may be? How does this play into that? Well, that's probably the level three, and, you know, probably about level two or three, right? And so, you know, one of the things I wanted to say about that is also, is, you know, I'll tell you what COVID has showed us, is showed us that kids need connections, right? And so I use a term, a statement that one of the senior administrators told me, there's a lot of online teaching going on, but there's not a whole lot of online learning going on, right? And so kids need connections. Kids need the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I always go back to that, right? They got the one and the two, but they need the three and the four. And so this goes right along with that, and it's frustrating for y'all that we're not able to get that going, but I know y'all continue to work forward with it, and I'm happy this is in our program and in our school district. So, but I'll tell you, and the other one of the things, public school teaches you a lot about how to deal with difficult people. I'm very proud of that. Somebody made that statement to me, a parent made that statement to me 2 weeks ago about, you know, the 31-year-old parent, and told me that I learned in public school how to deal with difficult people. I didn't blame the system, I blamed the person. And so I was able to get my point across without causing any controversy and things like that. So I learned how to bite my tongue, and so I always thought that was important, that people understand that, you know, a lot of schools teach that, but, you know, I think public school teaches that to an extent for a lot of our students. So thank y'all for that.
Any other comments?
I just have one other question. What is an equity collaborative?
Coin, rock, paper, scissors?
That's right. Well, and part of what we're looking at is equity in how we discipline, and equity how we interact with our students, the services and instruction we provide. And so it's, you know, we've only had our first one. We've got four more to go, and they've also offered some additional opportunities for our group to be able to participate in just extra learning on, you know, the PBIS restorative practices. When you're looking at discipline, you know, thinking about too the teacher's lens, mm-hmm. you know, and when we look at things like implicit bias, you know, how can we teach that? What strategies can we bring that back so that as we implement this PBIS and restorative practice piece, how can we also make sure, you know, like the culturally responsive council presented last year, the month after us, and we talked about how we would be working together as we did that. So that equity collaborative, I think, is going to give us some great strategies. There's other school districts participating.
Did you have to apply for it, Dr. Nixon, or did they, I mean, how did Region 4 decide who was going to be in this collaborative?
They made it available, and Dr. Watson and Mr. Berger were gracious enough. They required assistant superintendent participation. And so it was just a quick opportunity, and they said, if you're interested, let us know. And so I went down and begged and asked, and, you know, because five times, and they're 3-4-hour sessions. So it's, yeah, it's a significant,
any extra knowledge. That's,
you know,
great.
Time that's commitment.
Yeah.
But
what other districts are involved?
Oh, I don't know. Alvin's participating. I think there were six districts selected. Mr. Burr, I don't know that.
Was there a representation of small districts, large districts, you know, that kind of stuff, or is it just?
I don't know how Region 4 selected. We just applied.
Okay.
And then we were selected to participate, so.
Yeah. It'd be interesting to see who's on that list.
And I don't know that she shared that with us. Dr. Graffin-Reed at Region 4 is the one sponsoring that, and so I don't know that she's actually shared. We know Alvin because we know the people in Alvin. And
right.
So when we saw them on the screen,
right,
we knew that was them. But I don't think we as a group really had an opportunity to introduce ourselves or share what districts we were from.
Right.
There is a special ed director from each district that's mm-hmm. participating, the assistant superintendents, and then CNI directors.
Has there been any talk in those meetings, or, and I know it's just the first one, we learned something about an equity audit in a TASB conference, but I've not been able to find like another resource on that. Have they talked about those at all, or?
I don't think so. Dr. Bond, no.
Okay, just curious. And then the emergent tree piece, it seemed like early on there was a lot of friction between teachers and the idea of even like emergent tree was a bad word sort of thing. It feels like with any new learning curve, kind of what we're in with COVID as well, that there's always kind of resistance before we really grasp the new topic and moving forward with it. What's the temperature among our teachers of the word emergent tree right now?
Well, I'd have to double check with Dawn. I can tell you in the very beginning, I think part of it was emergent trees language and Pearland ISD language. And so Noelle Gray and Dawn Lissy worked really hard those first 2 years with, you know, clarifying, because they were like, well, we can't have a treasure box anymore. Well, no, that's not really what was said. So I think the beginning, you know, and with using, you know, a contract company, it takes a little bit for them to know us. Right. And mm-hmm. So that, I think, caused most of the friction. I mean, Dawn may speak to that, but I think that was the beginning. I think we're in a better place now. I think they've seen some results. I think the mentoring and coaching that Emergent Tree provides and the data, I think, has been really beneficial.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you for your, this is great.
Yeah, thank you very
Thanks
much.
Thanks, guys.
We
I look forward
it.
To the next presentation on it to see how well it's
right.
being implemented.
Right,
again.
Right.
So I've read the book the third time, so.
No.
All right. Thanks to everybody who was involved with that. Thank you all very much. The next item is the report on
COVID.
Yes, sir, Mr. President, members of the board. I'm going to go through a bunch of stuff, and feel free to slow me down. Enrollment, right now we're at 63% of the students have chosen, or their parents have, the on-campus, 63%. That moves from a 50-50 split for the first 9 weeks. So we think that's a very positive development. All teachers across Texas would say face-to-face is superior than remote learning.
And how are we on social distancing measures?
Okay, well, I'll get to that now. It depends on the school. One of the measurements that I've done is comparing the total number of students on a particular campus to the capacity, the building capacity of that. And right now, to use one statistic for the whole district, we're at about 53% of our capacity. But we have schools ranging from the low at Silvercrest of 41% of the capacity is being used by the number of students that are there now to 78% at Magnolia.
Wow.
So fairly wide differences
yeah.
there between folks. Because everybody always asks about high schools, Pearland High School has 50% of its capacity at this time. And DHS and Turner have 44%. PHS has on average, Mr. Palumbo is telling me, 18 to 19 students per class, but he has some what he calls hot spots of 23 to 25 students. In those classes, there is not possible to have a 6 foot separation, so he says it's closer to 3 feet in those classes.
So I think that's the concern is, you know, so in that case, our mitigation is masking and hygiene, right? That's it. And we got to stick to that.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Exactly.
That's it. Okay.
Dr. Kelly, how many cases, positive cases have we had with a student transfer from student to student?
Yes, sir.
At Pearland High School and the three high schools, let me ask that.
Yes. Until the issue that came up with the Pearland High School girls volleyball team, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Until then, every case appeared to be isolated in the sense that it was not a connection between students, it was something brought from elsewhere. It did not appear to result in spread or to be people that knew each other that were in the same classes.
Like they transferred it from student to student outside at like a social gathering or something, but not on campus.
Yeah, parent to student or so.
Yes.
But now with the girls volleyball team, it started with the varsity, a coach, and I think initially three or four, Mr. Moody would know more precisely, students had COVID, but because of their close, Okay. So then we began to think, is this because of volleyball? And, you know, just the close proximity and all that. And right now, I think I heard the statistic of 9 students between the varsity and the JV. At first, we weren't sure about the connection because varsity and JV don't interact that much. So out of an abundance of caution, I really admire Mr. Moody and the HR, Christine Beck and all the rest, for essentially taking this proactive step that the minute that there was multiple girls on the varsity, they instituted initially a 1 week quarantining where the kids went home, even though they weren't necessarily connected or in close proximity and all those definitions. Well, that turned out to be wise because the number of cases increased. And so this last week, I think my timing is Monday, as we found out about more cases, we have essentially shut down PHS volleyball at the varsity level and the JV level for 2 weeks. And it's hoped that that will mitigate it.
Teachers, right?
Yes,
too.
That means the whole program. In fact, it means that the last practice games, or in one case, a district game before the playoffs is eliminated, or maybe eliminated. Is that right, David? That last game. So, you know, right now. Go ahead, David.
Yeah, just real quick. It was initially it was 2 and 1. It ended up going to 9. It was 2 staff members, 2 coaches, and then 7 athletes. And the compliment really is to also to Mr. Palumbo and Mr. Pardo, because they collectively, we got together real quick on that decision. We started out with 1 week, and they made a decision as soon as we heard over the weekend that there was another JV case to shut down the entire program. So I think, if I remember Mr. Pardo saying that as soon as they come back, they'll move right into a playoff game.
Yeah. I think originally Dawson versus Pearland was the very last district game. Both teams are guaranteed to go on in the playoffs, so we have some flexibility there. But if you read today's dashboard, you'll see that there are 9 cases at PHS, and so we're talking about the combination of volleyball teams, the varsity and the JV. So to answer your question, Lance, that's the first case where we think that there is some connection that happened within the school environment. Whether that happened on campus, whether it happened as those girls associating at homes, or of course we don't know that.
My daughter's a part of that program, so I thought the school district and the athletic department did a good job of the 7, then moving it to the 14. The communication with that has been very, very excellent. So I commend the school district and Mr. Palumbo and everybody else involved in that. It's been wonderful, actually.
Changing gears, the TEA name for the particular teaching model that we're using is called the concurrent model. That's where you're teaching spontaneously both those who are in your classroom and those remotely. We were privileged and honored that the commissioner picked ourselves out and 2 other districts, 1 for each type of approach, our concurrent and 2 other approaches. There's a total of 4 approaches that people use, split staffing. I won't go into all that. But anyway, we're very privileged because basically we were asked to address all 1,200 superintendents in Texas about what we were doing and how we were doing it. And I didn't paint too rosy a picture because we are struggling with it. It is a very difficult thing to do, but I think we're on the right track.
And do you feel that way, Dr. Kelly, even after hearing the other strategies of the other 3 superintendents chosen and their models and what they discussed?
Yes, primarily because they're facing a very high amount of frustration with their models. And one of the, I think, if I was to say the chief advantage of ours that is totally missing from the other models is the ability to stay with the same teacher regardless of the decisions made, both for health reasons, you know, keeping the cohort the same, but also for academic reasons. And so there's some real struggles out there as they're moving kids back and forth after each 6 week or 9 week period, and changing teachers or changing arrangements. I'm going to talk a little bit further about that in a minute, on something related to that. So anyway, it was an honor to be looked at throughout the district. Now, the biggest issue.
I don't mean to interrupt, but yes. Just while you're there, I just wanted to applaud you for your efforts and the reputation that you have across our state as a superintendent, that you would be acknowledged by the commissioner of our state for a standing like that. So it speaks highly of you and the things that you offer our district. And so I just wanted to say thanks for your hard work.
Thank you, Crystal. But yes. You know, a lot of this started when the commissioner picked up the research and saw that we were like the highest scoring district for our particular things and came down here and announced that to everybody. That was a great moment, and I'm glad he still feels that way. The biggest problem across Texas, maybe across the nation, that everybody is dealing with right now in this pandemic is the failure rate, particularly among remote learners. That is the biggest issue by far. Some districts around us have said, or at least one, that their failure rate, particularly in urban areas, is 50 to 60% of the kids are failing. And are very difficult in some cases to contact. So I have some initial statistics for us, but they've cautioned me today that there's kind of, I don't know if I want to call it a glitch, but the system isn't ready right now to absolutely define remote versus on campus. But anyway, here's the total failure rate, meaning kids who are failing one or more subjects is somewhere around 17 to 18% in our district. I don't have a good feeling about which part of that is remote and which part is on campus, but we all suspect that it will be the remote number that's far bigger. The biggest problems are at junior highs and high schools. English 1 through 4 is the highest area of failure. There's rates there as high as 19% per, like, let's say, for English 1 at a particular high school. At junior highs, the failure rates are somewhere between 13 to 19% in the 4 core subjects. And so that's, of course, much too high. I don't yet, the folks really started putting together a comparison of last year to this year, but I'm not ready. I don't have that yet about how much that has increased, but it definitely has increased from their initial data that they gave me. Now, failure rates at the elementary schools are very low, very low. Like about averaging, I wrote down 1.5%. Now, here's something that I don't know if it'll be controversial, but it would be helpful. And that is, the commissioner has listened to us, and we have said essentially to him, we need more teeth to be able to bring struggling students on campus, because those are the kids either behaviorally or academically are way behind. Now, I don't mean to degrade the typical remote learner. There's many, many successful remote learners out there, but the biggest issue across Texas, like I say, is remote failure rates and in some cases behavioral problems. So the commissioner is going to allow school districts now to essentially require struggling students who are failing one or more subjects to come to the campus for their instruction. So we have just learned this. This is a development that came out this last week. And you have to file with TEA an attestation that says, yes, you're gonna do this, but do you have a district procedure allowing a meeting with parents? Do you have an appeal process? Do you have do you have exceptions for health issues or other issues? Have you given a 2-week grace period, et cetera, et cetera. So CNI is looking at this. They in turn will also be looking at it with principals and so on. We don't necessarily have to be that rigid about one class failing. We might make it a different rule, two classes, three classes. I don't know what we would do there, but we're just starting to look. But it is an advantage. There are students that we can use on campus, and we'll start making a lot better progress. Of course, the flip side of that is that social distancing is affected the more students that come on campus. And so there's some balance there that's going to have to occur. What else did I want to say about that? So we're in the just learning it. We got to run it through a lot of traps. If it is a big controversial decision, the board may choose to weigh in on it. If we were going to do this, what we're saying is we might employ it in January. And of course, that also would depend on the course of the pandemic and other variables.
Dr. Kelly, what's after talking to superintendents and stuff, what's the commissioner, pre-K through fourth? You know, I know several of my master trustee colleagues we talk about in the group. There are a lot of them, and even in multi-high school districts, they're having all their K through four or fifth grade students go back to campus because of the lack of, I guess, the transfer.
Yeah.
So it's not as apparent, and so they're seeing a lot of those people go back. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, another way to look at it is that, for example, since our own district is a good example of where transmission at the elementary level is extremely light. So do we say something like grades pre-K through four, or pre-K through six? For example, they have capacity in their schools, and we could say we're gonna do that for those grade levels, but not necessarily for the higher grade levels, because infection rates are low and the capacity is there. So we haven't reached that decision, but we're just thinking about maybe that's one way to look at it.
Well, yeah, because I mean, my biggest concern with especially those levels is the connection piece of kids that are at that age, right? They have to have that connection. I think that's a big portion
teachers
of what's missing.
Teachers would say that. Yeah, teachers would say that.
Yeah, and they have to have that as a base for learning and everything.
Now, the one caution I give is because you read these newspaper articles about districts can completely eliminate all remote learning if they choose. And just say, we don't do that here. If you want remote learning, you can sign up with another district. But the only districts that really are doing that are either small districts or ones that where you've got 85 to 90% of the parents already choosing on campus. So you can justify. Here, with the statistics I've given you right now, I think we're a ways away from that. But 63% of the parents on campus.
How many kids in the elementary level, K through four, are going on campus? What's that percentage?
I think I wrote it down. It's 69%. I've got that
and
somewhere
I think
here.
That's weighted, so it's averaged across the district, where the west side of schools are still very much 50-50, and the east side is almost like 90% at Shady Crest, I think. Maybe in the 80s, high 80s.
Rustic Oak is the winner with 78%.
Okay, 78, okay. Sorry. I knew there was an 8 in there somewhere.
Yeah. I've written all that down.
But I think it's a challenge, Lance, because I think there's very real concern, and I've seen parents hearing the rumblings of coming out of that TEA meeting, not from our district but from others, that they've basically said, if Pearland pushes this, then I'm taking my kid out. And if we continue to see a drop in enrollment, and maybe that's just temporary until we find solutions for COVID, but if we're coming to an end of the financial situation where they're not going to give us a waiver for enrollment and for participation in school, then we're going to need those kids enrolled in our district in order to continue collecting ADA.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that, but if we as a district were to say, okay, our goal is to get every K through four or pre-K through four kid back on campus, I would think that, unless you have an extenuating circumstance, right, but you could, maybe the model has changed in the kindergarten, in the elementary level, where there is one teacher that's teaching possibly remote and the rest are teaching on campus. Let's say, let me spitball here, let's say that 80% of the kids or 90% of the kids are back on campus, 10% Or
by all means, if that's the parents' choices, then I am full on for that. But I'm a little bit anxious about the idea of making a decision when, for the second 9 weeks now, a large majority of even elementary parents have told us that they don't feel safe sending their kids to school in an in-person setting, then at some point we have to listen.
I mean, depending on how this winter goes, it might flip back.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard all kinds of data projecting different outbreaks again towards the end of November and early December, and I think it's, if we don't have to make a decision on that now, let's wait to see what COVID does and then make some educated decisions from there.
I think the whole month of November we'll be looking at, but as some of our people pointed out to me, we need to give grace period and other time for people to adjust. So if we are going to do it, we need to make a decision, you know, as early as possible in December.
But I hear you saying from the elementary level, those kids are not being affected as much on the academic side as some of our higher grade levels. So even if we brought the kindergarten and elementary back, it's not making accommodations for those errors that we're seeing in the high failure rates at those higher grades.
Agreed.
True. I agree. I won't contest the point. I'll just say that back to Lance's earlier point, the elementary teachers will tell you they want those kids for the relationships.
Understood. And they need more hands-on, tangible. They need the centers. They need the socialization. They learn, I mean, they're without a doubt developmentally, they have higher needs to be back in school than some of the other grades.
Well, if nothing else, I'm hoping you appreciate the difficulty of some of those decisions as we move forward here in November.
Well, I guess it'd be a little bit easier if we knew the status of the rapid testing.
Yeah, I'm fixing to get to that.
Can I just go back to the failure rate piece again?
All right.
I just want to kind of corroborate that from the community side. There is a high level of discussion and posts in a lot of different ways, social media-wise, and even parents reaching out saying, my kids never failed before, and they're struggling now. And so I think not only are we seeing it from that side, but they're seeing it from their side as well. And so I think there is room for discussion, and there's open opportunity there. And I don't know if TEA is still allowing the flip days at the high school, like where it wouldn't
be
like
that choice.
The hybrid model
at the high school setting?
Under certain circumstances when there is a COVID outbreak.
Okay, but not as a model.
But not as a whole.
Okay. I'm just thinking, I mean, they're blaming it, parents are blaming it on inconsistent use of Canvas about how some teachers are inputting it and collecting data. I think any parent is like pulling at any opportunity to understand how they can better support their youth. But then the flip side of letting their kid have the independence of you should be able to navigate school and get through this. So I think it's a double-edged sword for the remote learner at those higher grade levels.
Also, I do think that our teachers and our principals are getting better at how to get better participation from remote learners, and they've tied some attendance things to it and so on, that, you know, because what they say is, you know, it's a lot better if those kids will sit there synchronously during the day and keep up than trying to asynchronously do the work for
that
particular
day
later.
I mean, I will say this, though, John, Dr. Kelly, is that, you know, we're 2.5 months into this, and, you know, with Canvas and all these different tools, that's a lot to absorb, you know, to learn a very complicated piece of software, to integrate that into a classroom. It's very complicated for these teachers to just jump right in and say, I'm going to be a master of this software.
Right.
It's very difficult. So you have to give them a lot of kudos for, you know, all the ones that I hear from that are putting in a lot of extra time to be as meticulous as they want to be or need to be to feel like their students need to succeed. That's a big deal, you know. And on top of that, integrating that software tool with others, that's not easy sometimes, you know.
I've seen some ingenious things that some of our teachers are doing.
Yeah.
It takes time to figure all that out. And then good example, you know, when a teacher does something really well, then the other teacher down the hall wants to say, how did you do that? And so that doesn't happen overnight. Okay, the total enrollment hold harmless funding is now in place for the whole semester. I think I told you that before. I think it reasonable that the state will extend that for the rest of the year, because it looks like they have money that can cover things for this biennium, though they do not have it for next biennium. Now, Georgiani tells me to be cautious there, because even though we get this hold harmless funding, we have a greater percentage of kids that are challenged than in the past. And so more money is needed, not just hold harmless, but to keep up with the increase in special ed, economic disadvantaged students, and so on. But anyway, I feel reasonably assured that we'll see some hold harmless funding for the year. Star testing. The commissioner is maintaining we're going to be star testing. How much of it is still on the table? Whether it will be just in the areas that the Fed requires it for their own accountability system, whether it's waived, whether it's just for people that absolutely have to have it, like seniors who need to graduate. So he has already reduced the EOCs in December to basically, I think, those who absolutely have to have the test. I remember the rule for right now. I personally, I've been saying this all along, I think star testing will remain in some capacity, and that that's actually useful to us for data and so on, but that the accountability system needs to be either for this year set completely aside or very much greatly reduced. And there, we would do fine on it, but a lot of schools that are struggling, districts a lot more than us, it'd be practically impossible for them to earn a grade A through F. Through the action of Dorothy Simpson, Mr. Berger, and others, that grab-and-go ability for all kids or all their parents to pick up food remains now, I think I told you previously, through December, and now it's through May. It's through the end of the school year. So that's a good thing.
How many do we have participating in that on average?
I have no...
Wow.
That was about 125 we're seeing pick up a day, remote students.
But, you know, as Larry is pointing out there, you know, students on campus getting free is also a much bigger number, probably. Okay, school funding is depending on the legislature. We expect some cuts as we go into the next biennium. If you listen to especially the Dan Huberty types that are very pro schools, that they want to continue to fund HB 3, House Bill 3. And so they can't, you know, they're in a quandary. If they decrease funding, that would really cut into HB 3. So I think there'll be some cuts, but I don't think they'll be too drastic. The other thing that they have warned us is protect your fund balances. And we are doing that by committing and assigning our fund balance, because some districts, you know, according to a few of the people that gripe about, a few of the legislators, you know, they've got a full year in fund balance and they don't need that. And we should go to them first before we give them more money. So,
well, I think as we saw in our recent audit, not this audit, but the, what was that one called? Sorry, my brain.
The efficiency audit.
That our fund balance is significantly lower than area districts or districts of comparison. So I think we're on target and doing well in that area. Or we're you could look at it another way. We don't have the reserves that other districts do in that area.
Okay, I have barely mentioned this to you, but, and it's an item for future discussion, but Georgiani has received updates on funding, new templates. There may be a different path to maximizing funding for us than the vote on the golden penny. This involves the disaster declaration by the governor that allows us to do some things with the tax rate next year if we choose. As Crystal and others have been pointing out, we're going to probably lose 3.5 cents on our INS side, so there's some flexibility. I don't want to go into that tonight, but there's ways to enhance our funding that in the wake of the Vader not going through. And with our new trustee, Dr. Scheffler and Ms. Carter, we'll be looking at those things over the next month or two. And then the final thing I think Jeff was asking about is COVID testing. Larry walks into me today and tells me he just received 6,400 tests and PPE to go with it, the protective equipment. And so funny thing about that is we're proceeding extremely cautiously because we're one of the few districts in our area that is going down this road. And so we want to make sure a lot of things are in place, how we're doing it, centralizing it, who actually does it, who is eligible to be tested. We're thinking that we're going to begin on a small scale with symptomatic faculty and staff. And if that goes well, then we'll move to symptomatic students. And that's as far as we're willing to say right now that we're contemplating. This is not a bed of roses, because even if it's implemented perfectly, imagine this situation. You are symptomatic, and you go and you get tested, and it comes out negative. But we are still saying to you, even though it's negative, you must continue in your quarantine period for 2 weeks. Well, why should I do that? I just tested negative. Well, this test, you may be negative on the particular day that test is governed, but you may not be 3 days later. And we aren't Nick Saban, who can have three tests in 1 week and be eligible for the Saturday Alabama game. So,
Dr. Kelly, is that 6,400 tests it, or is it a replenishable?
I don't know if Larry knows the formula, but I think it's you get some percentage of your enrollment plus 100% of your staff as the initial gift to all school districts who apply. Right now, it's very hard to say that, Crystal, because only it seems like a relatively few number of districts have applied. Therefore, there's probably a lot of excess testing up there. So that's as much as I know now. On the good side, the test is said to be 97% accurate, although Dr. Nixon, one of our statistician types, has said that the entire sample size was only 105 or something like that.
Oh, golly.
So we'll see on those things.
And what does the test actually entail? Is it the nasal swab that
we... It is a nasal swab, but here's the cool thing about it. And I've had two tests over the last couple of months.
Nasal swab
where they
is not cool.
Stick that thing way up your nose. This new test just touches the front of your nose, and then you insert it in this credit card deal, and then within 15 minutes it gives the reading. So
what?
The front of your nose right here?
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Huh.
Incubation period.
Touch your ear and test it.
Like an indicator.
One of the eyeball?
One.
Not the eyeball?
It goes okay. Up here.
There's no way it's accurate.
So that's my report, unless you've got other questions or...
That's good to know that we have access to the testing, you know, if we have that discussion in the future about more capacity and whatnot at the campus.
And I just want to have one other question, Dr. Kelly.
Yes.
When the emails go out to parents of a campus regarding a positive on that campus, does that mm-hmm. same email also go to all the teachers on that campus?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Because I'm hearing some rumors that teachers are not getting those emails and that they're not aware when there's a positive on their campus. Is it a new development? Mm-hmm. Okay.
No.
I love Dr. Nixon jumps to the ready. She's awesome like that.
From the beginning, we have a process for our directors and principals, and so it's kind of steps them through that process. So. There's a letter, that same letter that goes out to our families, goes out to the faculty and staff.
Okay, on the same day?
On the same day. I mean, it pretty much probably at the same time. I think Ms. Hocott and I both get copied on those, so often we'll see the one from the principal to the staff and then the one through Skyward to families.
Okay, awesome. Thank you for the insight. Mm-hmm. Much appreciated.
All right, any other questions? All right, Dr. Kelly, I show that we have the bond financial update and the interim financial statement. That's for the board members' consumption at your convenience. And I'm showing that is the entire agenda. Have I missed anything?
No, sir.
Charles, I just have one question on that last report, just real quick. And Georgian, you may be able to answer from there. But on the difference on the statement of revenues, the difference of the adopted and amended under instruction, of the $3 million, is that the PP protective equipment and the one-to-one devices?
You're looking at the general fund?
Page 75, yeah. Under the revenues, it would include the line item 11 under instruction. There's a difference of $3.1 million dollars between the adopted and the board amended.
And yes, part of it. Let me see. Can I control this?
I would just assume it would include that laptops, PPE, and any personnel. Is that correct?
This one is as of September 30th. And so remember, because we got to close the month, so it's always like a month behind. And where are you looking? That change is $5.1 million. What are you looking at?
Page 75 under line items of instruction. I guess my question is, if that is the laptops, one-to-one devices, does that fall under, I would assume it fall under instruction?
Yes.
And that's where the $3.1 million
yes,
difference
is?
Yes,
that is correct. The variance between the adopted and board amended. Mm-hmm.
Does instruction also include any new personnel as well?
No, we actually, I think we budgeted for an additional district nurse. So that's function 33. And then we also budgeted for two technicians, and that's function 53.
Okay. Thank you. That answers my question, okay. Mr. President.
All right. There was nothing else to come before the board. There's a group of people that I forgot to thank earlier for putting up with me, and that's my family. My wife and my two kids, you guys have been incredible. Throughout this 6.5 year journey. It's been a huge blessing for us, and we thank you all very much. And so for my final trick at 8:25, I will adjourn this meeting. Thank y'all.